People oftentimes complain about trade. They say that we rely too heavily upon other countries, that we should produce more things on our own. But what that misses is the idea that whenever we engage in a trade, there's some mutually beneficial action that's going on. Otherwise, we wouldn't engage in a trade. We get something that we want, and the other side gets something that they want. Now, the reason we trade with certain people is based on a concept known as comparative advantage. Think about it this way. Why don't we have coffee produced in the United States? It's not that we can't do it. It's that we just don't do it very well, and it would be very expensive for us to do it. Instead, we get coffee from places like Jamaica, from Indonesia, from parts of Africa, because those countries can produce coffee beans in a very low-cost fashion. We say that they have a comparative advantage in production. A comparative advantage means that you can produce something with a lower marginal opportunity cost. Remember, opportunity cost talks about what do you have to give up. And if you have a lower marginal opportunity cost than somebody else, it means that you're giving up less to produce a product. This is one of the most fundamental building blocks of trade. We buy things from people, we buy things from countries who can produce it more cheaply because we don't have to pay as much for it. Let's take a look at an example. Let's say we have two countries, and they can both produce two goods, ketchup and steel. Country A has three production possibilities. They can produce 1,000 gallons of ketchup and zero steel. They can produce 700 gallons of ketchup and 30 units of steel. Or they can produce no ketchup and 100 units of steel. Those are the production possibilities for this country. If we want to find out what they have to give up as they change their production levels, what we're essentially looking for is the marginal opportunity cost. We take what you give up and divide it by what you get. And what we're trying to find is how much you have to give up to get one unit of the other good. So, if we move from option 1 to option 2, we're giving up 300 gallons of ketchup. That's 1,000 minus 700. And we're dividing it by what we get in return, which in this case is 30 units of steel. If we take 300 divided by 30, we end up with a ratio of 10 ketchups to 1 steel. Incidentally, if you go from option 2 to option 3, you're going to get the same ratio, and I leave it to you to figure that out. In this case, the marginal opportunity cost of producing one unit of steel is 10 gallons of ketchup. Country B has three production possibilities as well. They can produce 90 gallons of ketchup and zero steel. They can produce 45 ketchups and 45 steel, or they can produce zero ketchup and 90 units of steel. If we figure out the marginal opportunity cost for that country as well, what we will find is that there is a ratio of one ketchup to one steel. Take what you're giving up and divide it by what you're getting. Now, left to their own devices, these two countries may choose option 2 on their production possibilities curves, simply because this allows them to have a little bit of both of the goods. And based upon this limited production possibilities table, that's the only option that allows them to have both goods. But what if we were to identify a way that each country could have more of both goods? In other words, they could consume beyond their ability to produce. This, of course, would be very interesting to them. So here is the proposal. One of these countries should specialize in producing ketchup, and that's all they should produce. And the other country should specialize in steel, and that's all they should produce. The question then becomes, which country should specialize in which product? And that's where we get back to comparative advantage. We know what the marginal opportunity cost for country one is, country A. Country A has a marginal opportunity cost of 10 ketchup to 1 steel. Country B has a marginal opportunity cost of 1 ketchup to 1 steel. So to produce steel, it costs country A 10 ketchups, and it costs country B 1 ketchup. It costs country B less, because 1 is less than 10, to produce steel. And therefore, country B should be in the production of steel, because they don't have to give up as much as country A would have to give up. If you find that one country has a comparative advantage in the production of one good, you can automatically assume that the other country has a comparative advantage in the production of the other good. Or we could go through the math. In this case, what we want to do is find out how much do you have to give up to get one unit of steel. That's what we knew before. We had to give up 10 units of ketchup to get one unit of steel. Now we want to figure out how much does it cost us to get one unit of ketchup. And to do that, we divide, in country A, we divide each side by 10. So that gives our ratio a 1 ketchup equivalency to 1/10 of a steel. Country B's math is very easy because it's still a 1-to-1 ratio. So who has a comparative advantage in producing ketchup? Well, that's country A, because they only have to give up 1/10 of a unit of steel, whereas country B has to give up an entire 1 unit. So country A should specialize in ketchup. Country B should specialize in steel, and then they need to determine how much they should trade. Let's say that they make a decision on trade, and country B will give country A 1 unit of steel for 5 gallons of ketchup. Does this make sense? Absolutely it makes sense, because now country B is getting more ketchup for a unit of steel than they could produce on their own. They were only able to produce 1 unit of ketchup, and they had to give up 1 unit of steel. Now they can get 5 from country A. And country A says, well, this is good because we had to spend 10 units of ketchup to get 1 unit of steel, and now we only have to spend 5. So they view this as a beneficial trade as well. Both sides are made better off, and the trade should commence, and now both countries can consume more than they were able to consume previously. Let's say that we decide to trade this 5-for-1 ratio. Country A says, we will sell you 200 gallons of ketchup in exchange for 40 tons of steel. Compared to the option they were producing at before, which was 700 ketchups and 30 steel, this is better for country A. They get more of both goods. Country B looks at this and says, well, now we're getting 200 ketchups and 50 tons of steel, whereas we were getting 45 of both before. This is a great deal for us as well. So if we're going to engage in trade, both sides need to be made better off, and the process of specialization can help make both countries better off and allow them to consume more than they were able to consume before, and in fact, consume more than they're able to produce.